try to do this in a different way. How many of you guys are familiar with WSO2 platform? Like, is this the new, like the very first time that you are learning about the platform? Very first time? You, sir? First time? Yeah. What about you, Trijan? First time? Okay. First time first. No, okay. Now, what I'm going to talk about is basically like this more like a platform introduction, but I'm specifically talking about applications, right? So the platform support for writing and doing various things with applications, right? I won't be going into details of any of the products as such, but it will give you a fairly good understanding of some of the core concerns when it comes to application development, which obviously all of you guys know, right? And what are the key components or products that are there to solve some of those problems, right? So during that process, obviously I may have missed certain things, so feel free to ask me like how this can be done, that can be done, etc. Since like there's very few of us, it will be pretty good to have a conversation too. So to start with, these are the type of applications that I'm going to talk about, and I'm going to talk about supporting WSO2 platform. So basically, starting from like writing web applications into desktop applications to mobile applications, and with IoT firmware type of applications, right? So that's the definition of application, at least for this session. And obviously, like these applications are made with a purpose, and in order to fulfill that purpose, these applications generally need access to some data, or it is built on top of an API. And obviously, like sometimes we'll need mediation, right? Because like the application could be accessing data from some system that, and the application is not capable of processing that type of data, so there needs to be some mediation that needs to happen, or else application could be sending out some data that needs to be mediated so that it can be consumed by some other application. Okay? Now, some of the key components that can be used to solve these three problems are the data services server. Okay? Now, this is actually a fairly old view of the data services server. It has like expanded a lot. Now, basically, data services server is something that will eliminate all the boilerplate code that you have to write if you are accessing various type of data sources. Say, for example, if you want to create services or REST resources out of spreadsheets, databases, Google spreadsheets, CSV files, all that, data services offered a wizard-driven or a configuration language-driven approach of creating that. Right. So if you are really familiar with a spreadsheet, and if it is simple enough, creating a SOAP type of a service or a REST type of a resource using data services wouldn't take more than 5 minutes. It's that simple, right? But if it is complicated, yes, you have to do it because like it's some significant amount of thing that you are doing. So what it would do is at one end of it you have different data sources. And on the other end of it, you will end up creating data services so that applications can consume it without even knowing what the backend type of data is, data storage is. And the advantage is, like, you are eliminating, from a development point of view, you are eliminating all the boilerplate code that you have to write to access a spreadsheet or a database, all that. So this is, like, according to some architects, this is kind of an anti-pattern, because like, but like we have this used to be the second highest largest deployment among customers up until 2 years ago. Then came the API manager, which kind of like took off all the deployments. So then, in order for the applications to access data, the second point that I highlighted was having APIs. Now, the API manager is a key component that will allow you to do that. So basically, what API manager can do is, it can access your services layer, where the existing implementations are, right, and convert that services layer into a properly managed APIs, right? So the difference between this part and this part is, like typically when it comes to services or the things that you created with service-oriented architecture, you primarily focus on the implementation side of it, like and UDDI never took off. So in the APIs world, there's a more pragmatic approach of finding out the service, finding out about the APIs. Basically, there are API portals, and there's a more pragmatic way of subscribing and accessing those APIs, unlike in the services world. So that is one of the primary differences between this layer and this layer. And of course, with the API management layer, now in the services world, you could be how you access the service, how you get access to the service, could be fairly different to how you do that in the API management layer, where there are tokens involved, and probably like if it is APIs, you would end up using OAuth tokens. Now, API manager is something that is fully capable of doing that, basically converting existing services into properly managed APIs. And also, the other way is also possible, where you could be having, you could be accessing certain cloud services. Say, for example, you are having an internal Twitter application, a Twitter application that represents your corporate, and you want a couple of people from marketing to tweet on behalf of the company. Right? So what you would do at that particular point is, you would create a proxy Twitter API at this layer, and have internal applications, all of which will tweet on behalf of the company. So both ways, either exposing your stuff to outside or getting external cloud services back into the enterprise. Right? So these, yeah. And of course, the third one is the ESP. So basically, ESP is, I'm sorry about this, some of these lines are not clear. Basically, just think of ESP as an remediation engine. Yeah, you can have like apples on one side, and you want to convert those into oranges, ESP can do that. And at the same time, while converting those into oranges, if you want to convert part of it into carrots, that's like, it's basically it. So ESP is actually a mini workflow engine. Basically, it receives messages and on-the-fly processes then push it out, right? And now there's a different WSO2 product called WSO2 Business Process Server that is pretty much doing the same thing, but meant for long-running things, where like things would run days. So these are three primary components that are available for applications to access data or push out data. And like messaging is something pretty old. And applications, when they want to communicate with different other systems, they need to have a proper message broker, right? Now, WSO2 message broker is yet another component that is absolutely critical when it comes to developing applications. So what I have here is a diagram that explains how a message broker is typically used, right? So at one end, you could be having a system, right? And then from those systems, you could be getting messages into a broker layer, and maybe you are using the ESP or some other system to consume those messages, right? Now, here, of course, something important. Now, when you are writing applications in this era, it's pretty important that that you are able to connect to other systems that are known. Say, for example, you could be managing a sales data in the Salesforce. You could be like tracking certain activities, marketing activities using Twitter, right? Now, what WSO2 has done is, on top of our enterprise service bus, we have written this connector store. We have pre-built connectors for some of the known systems that are out there, known and frequently used systems that are out there, right? So I was talking about the message broker, but like I happened to mention about this. Now, basically, message broker is, it supports, it's pretty much a standard message broker that will be absolutely critical for application development. And, of course, once the applications are, like, developed, once it's running, these applications need to support clustering, failover, supporting microservices type of architectures, and of course, like containers, if you have been listening to what Tyler and the previous presenter was presenting. So this is a very simple diagram of a particular component that WSO2 is having, the application server, right? I'm actually going to talk about application server towards the last part of it, but since it is appearing here, I'll just explain what this is. Application server is a place where you can deploy applications, deploy web applications, JAX-RS, JAX-WS type of applications. And the web application deployment capability is actually coming from Tomcat, right? Where we have taken a Tomcat container and made it multi-tenanted, right? Now, coming back to the topic, what we support is like basically you can have you can deploy the application into a single server, but you can have this application run in a cluster. So how this happens here is, now in this particular case, okay, I'll go to a somewhat complicated one, but like I wouldn't want to explain it using here. Now how it happens here is, you deploy the application into one of the servers, and there's a mechanism called, which is not mentioned in here, called deployment synchronizer. Okay? So what it would do is, the mechanism would actually connect all of these servers into a single deployment server, and that is powered by either Git or SVN, right? So once a certain application server gets an application deployed, it will ensure via clustering, we use Hazelcast clustering, it the other application servers knows about the new application that just got deployed, right? So by knowing that, it will pull the repository, which is not mentioned in here, and get the updated ones. Right? So what it would mean is, when it comes to a requirement where the application needs to be auto-scaled dynamically, right? We just take a vanilla application server instance, point it to an already configured deployment synchronizer server, and boot it up, right? And it will automatically get the relevant artifacts deployed. So it can auto-scale, right? And with the microservices and container type of architectures, this is absolutely critical because that supports the supports what is being discussed around containers. Because you just take a vanilla distribution and point it to a server and boots up, and it automatically after like some time it gets the configurations. Okay? And I wouldn't want to go into detail like this discussion of this, but due to how WSO2 products are made, now all these WSO2 products are coming from a common server framework called WSO2 Carbon. So what we have done is, done in the Carbon approach is, we have like we have realized that before coming to that, we have close to 25 servers, right? 25 servers, and what we have realized is all of those servers are having common requirements like logging, clustering, user management, all that, right? Registry, all that. So what we have done is we have abstracted out all those functionalities into a common framework, server building framework called Carbon, right? So whenever we want to build up a new server, what we do is we take the Carbon server building framework and add certain features on top of it and call that the server X, right? Now, what it would mean is the common things like clustering, the concepts that you apply for clustering and failover are available across all the products, right? And from a deployer or from a user's point of view or from a DevOps point of view, the approach that you follow to cluster the product X is pretty much equivalent to configuring clustering on product Y. Okay. And so this is not like complete identity, but typically when you write applications, like there used to be an era, and there are like development that are happening where you are managing user management, identity management on within the application itself, right? Which should actually end up having identity silos, where like one application is having its own user store, another one having its own user store, etc. Now, what WSO2 Identity Server can do is, it can provide identity servers, services on top of an application, for an application. So basically, if an application wants to get a certain user user verified authentication part of it. It would send in the credentials, and the identity server can verify so that it can proceed. Or else, if it wants to get authorization done, identity server can also do that, and we support like pretty much industry standards like XACMEL, Scheme, all those. This is pretty much a detailed architecture diagram of identity server. So basically, what I wanted to highlight here was like we support connecting to, say, for example, if you are managing your user accounts in some of these systems, we support connecting into these different systems, so that it's a federated identity that comes out of the identity server, right? So that you wouldn't have to worry about federating all of these different identity systems, right? Just take the identity server, connect to whatever the identity provider, right? And if a particular provider is not there, there's an extension mechanism where you can extend, right? And then to your enterprise applications, you are exposing a single identity server that provides a standard way of accessing a user. It's pretty much similar to the story that I mentioned in the data services world. If you guys have any questions, just feel free to ask it.
Only one for me.
Yeah.
That means that you can also provide equivalent mechanism of two-factor authentication providing two service providers at the same time?
Yes. Right. Yeah. Yeah. Not an identity guy, so if you ask me another question on that, I will not be able to answer. But yes, we do support two-factor authentication. Actually, there are customers who have implemented two-factor authentication on top of identity server for the API store. So basically, if you take the API manager, and API manager's API portal allows developers to sign up and log in, right? So most of the customers wouldn't want any random developer to come in and sign up, right? So what most of the customers do is they take the vanilla distribution and extend the sign up process. So there are multiple factors that are involved, it's pretty much a common pattern.
Sorry, I don't quite understand the pattern. What's the question? Can you
sign up? Okay. Okay, in my answer, I kind of like gave answer for two scenarios. One is, these identity providers, it's actually here, the authorization manager. Now, in the default implementation, you just pass in the credentials and get the credentials verified and single factor. The credentials are valid, that's it, right? But if you want, you can extend that so that there are multiple factors that are being considered, right? So I was like trying to reset my Google password in the morning, and it asked me for a question and it sent me SMS to my phone. So after multiple factors, it gave me the password reset option, right? So multi-factor authentication, so it's like, and typically, when you write applications, there comes a situation where you need to manage these configurations separately. Say, for example, if I take this one. Okay. By the way, most of these diagrams that I'm using are standard deployments that we have done at different customers, but we have sort of like generalized it so that none of the customer information are here. Right. So in this particular case. If you can remember, I said, I said you can deploy applications into application server, right? Now, the application server, whenever an application is deployed, it sends out WS discovery messages into the governance registry. So, since this is the first time that I'm telling about the governance registry to you, right? Just imagine governance registry as the Windows registry. So it's pretty much, when you take the Windows operating system, it uses the Windows registry to keep all the configurations, all the licenses and everything, Right? Now, in the case of Windows registry, it's per OS within a box, whereas the governance registry can be a separate, it is a separate product. Customers deploy as a single entity, right? And within that, it can keep configuration details about anything, virtually anything a system can use. Now, this is pretty much like at the very core of it, it's a folder structure, right? Where we called collections, and the things that you put inside there are called resources. So one good example is, so if you take, I was actually talking to a customer in the morning, and they have different event definitions. Like they are dealing with a couple of IoT sensors, and each of these IoT sensors are having different like event definitions. Temperature is defined in one way, how they measure the light is another way. So what they do is, now those definitions are pretty much standard across the devices that they are manufacturing, but these devices have different versions. So the event stream, the definition slightly changes. What they are doing is they are doing the using a governance registry to store those event definitions, basically a JSON schema, and then they are like pulling it out. This guy has an API, a REST API and a web services API, pulling it out into their corporate, so not corporate, but their website, so that if somebody wants to access a certain type of sensor data, it gives the sensor data definition. So in this case, the configuration is managed inside here. A very basic example. So likewise, there are customers who are keeping some of their documents, like the documents that they create for SDKs and everything within the governance registry. There are customers who are keeping certain deployment-related things inside the governance registry, so that whenever an application moves from one environment to another, they have written the application in such way so that in order to get the passwords or different URLs, different paths, they access a certain part of the governance registry. Right? So the same application, when it moves from staging into, development into staging, in order to get certain database URLs, certain file system locations, etc., it just goes through the governance registry and picks it up. So that when you want to lifecycle manage the application, you don't have to change the binary of the application, but rather, not me, but rather have a separate repository that manages it. Right? Now, this particular product has two words, the registry, right? I'm sorry, I used the term repository, which is kind of, yes. Okay, yeah, I knew somebody would ask that. So you actually you can use multiple registries, right? But this guy supports having different hierarchies. So what typically would customers would have is they would have different locations for like staging, production, blah blah blah, right?
Separate,
yeah, and usually they have testing, staging, development point into one, production. Yeah, it's fine if, it wouldn't. I was going to tell something else. Now, previously I used the term repository, which is kind of wrong, because repository is the place where you keep things, where you actually store the things. Registry is a separate API on top of it. So registry part supports giving versions, creating resources, and all that. Right, and the term governance is there because you can actually write your own set of rules on top of the registry. Right, so a typical rule would be, let's say, I actually forgot a very good example. All the WSDLs, the service definitions, are kept inside here. Right, like when some customers deploy services. Now, let's say somebody comes and changes the WSDL. And the governance registry has a extensible mechanism where you can plug your own code whenever somebody modifies a particular resource, in this case a WSDL, you can get notified or some other action gets triggered, some other verification. Basically, it's an interface that you have to extend so that you can virtually perform any action on top of that resource action.
Okay? Like,
Okay.
Is this all about, just about looking at who may consume what, or can I have also other methods to throttle the usage of resources at that level?
Okay. You can actually throttle, because what happens is, like, whenever you read a resource from the governance registry that is seen from the system as a get on a particular resource, right? So you can actually enable statistics for that, which will go into our data analytics part of it, right? So you can actually see, like, how many times a particular resource has been accessed. But typically what we do is, like, for resources that are not changed frequently, we cache it on top of the governance registry so that it wouldn't, a particular call wouldn't go into the right end of it. And when it comes to clustering scenarios, if you want to cluster governance registries, what we do is, if a certain resource gets modified in one registry, using the same pattern, we don't push the resource, but we tell if you have a cache of that particular resource, invalidate it, so that next time it'll pull it from the actual location. This again event store type of a scenario, right? And this particular part is, like, typically, not typically actually, all the applications have a life cycle, and what we have in this space is a product called WSO App Factory. Now, unlike the other products, all the other products that I have mentioned so far are in the range of like 300 MB, which you can download and run it on your laptops or like any machines. But this guy is actually fairly bulky at this point, because what we do is, like, for each of these phases, we have plugged in an open source implementation. Say, for example, in the case of continuous build, that is Jenkins. Right, so we have plugged in a Jenkins, and we are also in the process of providing an interface so that you can plug your own build server. Right, and for example, in the case of issue tracking, we have Jira plugin. Right, Jira by default plugged in, and test automation, it's a combination of JUnit, find bugs, all that MR. So, due to that particular fact, this is kind of a bulky product. Right. But what we are trying at an architecture level at these days is we are removing all the products that we have plugged in, but we are introducing introducing interfaces so that anybody can write their own plugin to a system that they are using, because it's fairly difficult to sell this particular product due to how it is right now, because typically we wouldn't go into a green field and try to sell this. Most of the customers have their own practices on their set of tools. So. This is about the application lifecycle management. Yes. Okay. Okay. What it does for you is, it would be fairly obvious if you go to WSO2's App Cloud. It is cloud.wso2.com, right? Now, what it would do is, let's say I have this need to create an application, to track elephants. Right, to track elephants. So I have a data feed that is coming in, giving me locations of different elephants. And I want to create an application. Now, typically, let's say you don't have this. What you need is, you need a source code repository to host that application, a Git or a SVN. Now, what this guy is having is a place. It has its own Git. So you go in and enter the application name, and it would create a Git repository for you, right? Alongside that, it would also create an issue tracking system for you, issue tracking project, and it would also create a build script for you, basic one, and using that build script, it will push that into the continuous integration server, right? And you can also, this guy will have its own application servers to which the applications will be deployed. Right, all that part of this offering. That is why this is bulky. Right, now what it would mean is, if a particular particular company takes this offering, right, they wouldn't have to worry about maintaining a separate build server, maintaining a separate issue tracking system, or like Git repository for their developers. Right, and that itself is a difficult thing that makes it that for us to sell this, because typically a customer has like most of these things, right? But these are nice. These actually a story that is being captured by many customers, because like most of these customers today are looking at coming up with their own APIs, API stories, and everything, right? Now having APIs is not enough, because like the purpose of having an API is you want to like next step is the creating applications. API is just an enabler, right? So now if you go to Facebook, what Facebook has done is they have exposed the APIs, and they also have a very nice application development platform where you can develop the application and deploy it within the Facebook infrastructure itself, right? Of course, they are using different things like CloudBees, etc., but they are not exposing that particular fact to outside. So the cost that you have to develop a Facebook application is fairly less. Only all you need is a development head, engineering head, that's it. So that's the purpose. And then these are where the application server comes in. I didn't put a deployment diagram because like we have already talked about it. And this is something fairly new. We released this last week, right? Now, the purpose of this guy is, now, typically, like when you create applications, let's say like enterprise applications. Now, even within WSO2, we are using close to 25 applications that we have done for different purposes. Say, for example, if you want to order a taxi, if you want to order some lunch, if you want to, like, we have our in-house, like, different hardware request systems. Now, whenever somebody new joins in, there's no central place for people to go in and discover. Right now, it's a Google spreadsheet shared with all the new guys at the induction, right? Now, what this particular product does is it has three main components, actually four, where whenever somebody develops an application, right, he goes into the application publisher and tell, I have developed this particular application, right, and it goes through a lifecycle process where like he will end up adding documentation, adding different examples on how to use that application. And once it gets approved, it will start appearing on App Store, pretty much similar to the API Store, App Store, so that anybody who logs in new, comes in new, can see what are the applications. Right? And of course, at the runtime, it will go through the app gateway where we can like enable single sign-on. Right. Now, what we have done with this particular product is, if a particular enterprise is having the need of creating applications, one thing is we are by default supporting single sign-on, and we are also using our identity server. We are offering the authentication and authorization as part of service, so that an application developer wouldn't have to worry about writing their own logic to get a user verified, or writing their own logic to get their privileges verified. Those are available as set of headers to them because whenever an application is being accessed, we intercept that call, see if the call is an authenticated one. If not, we go to the identity management system, get it verified, and push it to the backend application. Okay. So the story is pretty much similar to the APIs, but here we are dealing with backend web applications. In the case of APIs, these are implemented services. Now, this is a screenshot of the application store. Now, this is what a newcomer would see, and they can like click on an application, they can sign up, and they can subscribe to these applications, and like a couple of details about the application. And this is the publisher's view, like where each of these applications will have its own lifecycle stage, and you can go inside and see what are the URLs that are freely available, what are protected, etc. And of course, like the statistics part of it, like I wouldn't talk about it because like we have a couple of strokes on statistics. So it is basically using WSO2 data analytics platform. And we have a separate ID that we have revamped and we are building on top of Eclipse J. Now, right now, the experience is not super. We have discarded what we had before and writing on top of Eclipse Day, so that it'll appear as a web-based IDE. That's pretty much it, like from starting an application to how you would use to develop it.